yesterday, an Indian immigrant and father of one of the girls on the team, knew almost nothing about basketball, and his girls had practically no skills. Growing up, Vivek's sports were soccer and cricket. In soccer, when one team gives up the ball, the other team immediately contests it, and they try to get the ball back. So Vivek, from Vivek's perspective, the fact that after a basket, most basketball teams automatically retreat to their own end of the court and give up three quarters of the court was totally mystifying. He decided that the only way for his girls to compete for the teams that were obviously outmatching them in terms of skill was not to give up that three quarters of the court, to go to a full court press all the time. He spent his practices concentrating on improving girls' endurance to help them keep up the pressure, knowing that he could much more quickly improve there than on shooting or running plays. Glavel notes that the 18th century general Maurice de Saxe famously said that the art of war was about legs, not arms. So he gave his girls the legs to go the distance and basically had them wave their arms madly around any time the other team got the ball. And his team won. And won. And kept them winning on their way to the national championship tournament. If the other teams had made it to the other end of the court, they could easily beat the U.S. girls. But most often, they never even made it there. They were completely overwhelmed by this full court press, and they would either not be able to inbound the ball or throw it away in a panic, and his girls could make an easy layup. Glavel's point in the article is that if his team had played by the establishment's way of playing, they would have lost at that game. But they didn't accept the conventional wisdom of their time, and they used their strengths, their legs, rather than their arms. Here in the movement for housing rights in the U.S., I say that most athletes are like the regular basketball players. They play by the establishment's rules that say housing isn't a basic human right, and they lose, whether it's the demolition of public housing, the underfunding of other affordable housing, or emergency shelters, the criminalization of homelessness, whatever. They give up that three quarters of the court because rather than going with the best framework for talking about these issues, the framework that says housing is a basic human right, and that people are entitled to certain treatment that's just a part of the government's obligation to uphold their basic human dignity, they try to make do with the limited privileges and semi-entitlements granted in U.S. law. Now, it's true that many advocates and lawyers have gotten very adept at using some of these tools in the U.S. system, and it's not that the underdogs never win using the establishment. But we're not much closer to the goal of ending and preventing homelessness for it, because they aren't fighting for the right to housing for the fund. They're just fighting for the low pieces that they have. Many of them will tell you that they do believe in a right to housing, but that it's not practical. The public isn't ready. The judges aren't ready. The legislators aren't ready. But I say that's playing by the establishment's game. And that's why we keep losing. I say we can't give up that three-quarters of the court. We need to go to a full court press for the human right to housing all the time. That means every public action, every press release, every court filing, every interaction with a client should be based in a human rights framework. It doesn't mean ignoring what you're doing already. And in fact, what you're doing is human rights work. You are all human rights activists. Whether or not you're calling yourself that is a different question. But it doesn't mean that we should just throw in human rights in a non-strategic manner. Obviously, there's going to be times when we have to ratchet things back and times when we push harder. But we're not going to win if we keep automatically conceding three quarters of what we're really fighting for. So as we go on to this conference, we're all going to learn a lot about different ways advocates are protecting the rights of homeless people. Unless you're in one of my workshops, you're probably not going to hear about how it fits into the human rights framework. But I encourage you all to check out the materials on your CD, to go to our website, think more about how you can start talking about your work in the human rights terms. You can start with small steps, a brief reference in a press release, a footnote in a legal brief, talking with your clients about their rights as human beings. For those who want more help or to get involved, we at the Law Center are here to help, whether it's developing a campaign, working on a legal brief, promoting your issues to international bodies. But as you go on with your work, even if you're not defining it